Hi, I'm Gauri Bhave, and I'm going to be talking about multicolor quantum dot LEDs using solution process electron transport layer. So recently there has been a lot of research on fabricating quantum dot LEDs, but most of this research has been focused on creating LEDs for display purposes. So we are targeting an application where we want to create quantum dot LEDs for imaging of biological samples, mainly cells. So what we want to do is that we want to make a high throughput imaging system where we have a microwell array system which can have cultured cells with where we can test various drugs, and we can image these cells and monitor them continuously. So for this reason, the LEDs that we create, we have some different requirements as compared to the LEDs required in display systems. The main requirement is that we have to make individually addressable multicolor LEDs on a single substrate. And they should be long lasting, and also the intensity does not have to be very high, since we want to continuously monitor cells dyed with fluorescent stains, and we do not want any photo bleaching of these fluorescent stains. So so the fabrication processes that we apply to creating these quantum dot LEDs are somewhat different from those applied in display purposes. So the reason we choose quantum dots for making these LEDs is because of the specific characteristics of quantum dots that we want to manipulate or use for this purpose. The first characteristic that we need to use is the narrow emission bandwidth. The reason that this is important is because since we are making multicolor LEDs, and also since we are using cells stained with various fluorescent dyes, we need to control the the bandwidth, which is the excitation bandwidth for those particular fluorescent dyes. Also, the emission bandwidth of the quantum dots depends upon the size of the quantum dots, and this size is controllable during fabrication. And the fabrication of quantum dots is silicon process compatible, and it's also very easy. So we can control the emission wavelength of the quantum dots very well. So in this case, we can create quantum dots of various emission wavelengths, and also use them since they are individually addressable. We can use them for various excitation wavelengths of various sizes. So the device structure we are using is a sandwich structure, in which the quantum dot layer, which is the emission layer, is sandwiched between an electron transporting layer and a hole transporting layer. And we supply voltage to the cathode and the anode. And we are fabricating the LEDs on a glass substrate, and the emission will be through the glass substrate. So all the layers below the quantum dot layer and between the glass layer and the quantum dot layer have to be transparent, since the emission is through the glass layer. So for the anode, we are using a 250 nanometer thickness ITO layer, which is sputtered, and we can thermally anneal the ITO layer to get the resistance of the anode that we need, depending upon the thickness of the HTL and the ETL. So we can vary it as required. We are using a 10 nanometer aluminum oxide layer, which is deposited through atomic layer deposition. This layer mainly acts as an insulation layer and also as a hole injecting layer. We're using a 5 nanometer nickel oxide layer as the main hole transporting layer. And the thickness of this layer is very important, because it has to be transparent for the emission to be seen clearly. On top of the quantum dot layer, we use a 50 nanometer zinc oxide nanoparticle layer, which is spin coated. This is the main novelty of our device structure, because in most literature, the electron transporting layer is usually sputtered onto the quantum dot layer, because the quantum dots themselves are spin coated, and to preserve the quantum dot layer well, they have to sputter the electron transporting layer, which causes quenching of the quantum dot. We are using a 30 nanometer thickness aluminum layer, which is sputtered on. That is the cathode for our device. So what we want to do is that we want to control the area of emission of our quantum dots, because we want to create multicolored quantum dots on a single substrate. So we have to control the emission layer. So we do patterning in two ways. One is microcontact printing of the quantum dot sensor, and the second is the patterning of the electrodes. So for microcontact printing of the quantum dots, we use a Langmuir Schaefer method, in which we use a Teflon ring in water to create a convex surface of water. And on this convex surface, we pipette a colloidal solution of quantum dots in hexane as the solvent. So the hexane, being volatile, evaporates and leaves behind a monolayer film of the quantum dot, which can then be picked up using a PDMS tank and transferred onto the nickel oxide layer, which is the whole transporting layer. So using the shape and size of the PDMS tank, we can make we can control the size of the quantum dot films that we are stamping on or printing onto the layer. And also we can select the area where we want the emission to come from. The second way is electrode patterning. In this case, the intersection of the cathode and the anode is the area from where we expect emission from the quantum dot layer. So we pattern the electrodes, we pattern the intersection area of the electrodes using photolithography to control the area of emission from the quantum dot layer. So we get electroluminescence using this kind of a device structure. So the first structure that we use, which is used in most literature for display purposes, is that is a structure where there is no aluminum oxide layer, and also the zinc oxide layer, as I mentioned earlier, is sputtered on. So the first problem with this structure is that with the whole transporting layer being really thin, and it's fabricated using e-beam evaporation. So when we do e-beam evaporation of nickel onto the which is only 5 nanometers thick, it causes clusters and it does not cover the the anode properly. This causes direct contact in certain areas of the quantum dots with the anode, and which causes burning of the quantum dots, and also it does not give us very uniform illumination from the quantum dot layer. Also, because the zinc oxide layer is sputtered on, it is not very uniform and it cannot give full coverage to the quantum dots, which again brings the quantum dots in contact with the aluminum cathode, which causes burning of the quantum dots. And the quantum dots are not protected from the environment. Due to this, such kind of quantum dot LEDs can emit light for about 3 to 4 hours. And as we can see in the figure, we find clusters where illumination occurs, and also we do not get uniform illumination over the entire area. So we made changes in the fabrication, and we used an aluminum oxide layer which was 10 nanometers thick and which was done using ALD, because of which it gave a very uniform layer and it protected the quantum dots completely from the anode. And also because of the aluminum oxide layer, the affinity between the quantum dots and the aluminum oxide layer is higher than that between the zinc oxide layer and the quantum dots. Because of this, we could do spin coating of zinc oxide on top of the quantum dot layers, and hence because of the spin coating, we can form a very uniform thick layer of zinc oxide on top, which protects the quantum dots completely from the aluminum cathode. So we got a very uniform high illumination LED from the entire surface where we expect the emission from, and these LEDs lasted for more than 300 hours with stable emission. So the first characterization of our LED that we did was the IV curve. So we can see the activation voltage because of the aluminum oxide layer and also the spin coating of the zinc oxide. The activation voltage is quite low, which is between 5 to 10 volts, and the current levels are also very low. Because of this, it causes the LEDs to not heat up too much, and because of which they last for a longer time. So we can see if we created LEDs with two wavelengths, which is 600 nanometers on the top and 580 nanometers on the bottom. So we showed preliminary results of cell imaging, which is our final application. In this case, we used breast cancer cells, which were MDA cells stained with HEMA-3 dye, and they were fixed on a cover slip. The cover slip was kept on top of our LEDs, and we imaged using a fluorescence microscope without any filters and with our LEDs as the excitation source. On the left, we can see a figure of the transmission spectrum of the HEMA 3 dye, which shows minimum transmission at 580 nanometers. Because of this, we expect to see a higher absorption in the nucleus from the 580 nanometer LED as compared to the 600 nanometer LED. So on the left are the figures taken with 580 and 600 nanometer LEDs on a black and white CCD camera, and on the right we see that the nucleus absorption from the 580 nanometers is quite much higher than the absorption of the nucleus from the 600 nanometer LED. So from these preliminary results, we can say that our LEDs can be used for imaging of cells and for detecting certain morphological features such as nucleus size or cytoplasm size and so on. So in conclusion, we fabricated multicolor quantum dot LEDs which on a single substrate and with a long lifetime and stable emission for more than 300 hours. The fabrication process novelties were a solution process ETL, which caused low quenching, higher emission and a longer lifetime. And we showed potential for fluorescence imaging of cells using our quantum dot LEDs, and we showed preliminary results from the fluorescence imaging of MDA cells using quantum dot LEDs. Thank you to all our funding agencies.